My name is Dan Furlan. I'm the past president of the Charleswood Historical Society. I'm also a member of the Council of the Manitoba Historical Society, so I'm really pleased to be here. And today we're going to be talking about the historic river lots in Charleswood. We'll talk about the river lots, how they came to be, some of the people who lived on those river lots and settled there, and also some of the developments that happened in the Charleswood area. It's about the people of the land. Charleswood is now a rural community and has been from time to time in the past, but there have been people there for a long time. We have evidence of Aboriginal settlements there for 5,000 years at the Hyper site, just outside of Charleswood in Headingley. It takes us to them, plus also trading patterns that bring them in touch with people far to the south. So we've had a growing caste, a changing caste of people. We have tribes coming from the south. We have the Ojibwa from the east, the Soto from the east. From the south, we have the Hoda or Dakota, the Cree and the Blackfoot, the Assiniboine from the west, and the Crow. And from the north, we have the Chippewa. So the Red River Valley, and Charles is being part of that, is a very popular place in the past. Now, going ahead to the sequence of events, we have a series of things that have taken place. Before the major settlements took place, we had trading back in the 1600s and 1700s. The fur traders came through there, passed the Assiniboine River through Charleswood. River Sound was established. From there, we have the settlement of Aboriginal and then Métis settlements around the trading posts. Métis settlements growing up around those posts as the marriage between the Europeans and the Native women took place and the offspring became the Native Métis nation. Then we all know about suffrage rent of large land to the from the Hudson's Bay Company. And then the 1817 treaty with the local tribes, which, by the way, Pegasus pointed out 30 years afterwards, still had not been lived up to. So that was a concern that continues to this day. Now, specifically about the land, there were surveys, Hudson's Bay Company surveys, 1813, 1835, and then the 1850s to 60. And after that, moving towards provincial status, the Métis, the original settlers on the land, had been there for a long, long time. They're issued scrip for these river lots, and we'll talk more about that in a couple moments. The Canadian Survey came in with a different style, a square township type of approach. We'll talk about that and the problems that led to that. But those river lots still exist. The river lots are still a part of Manitoba's legal real estate operation, so it still exists today as a legal entity. So Hirsch Rant, as we know, resulted in the high insurance, which is also about land. His land grant was basically the size of Scotland five times over. It's a huge, huge area. Of course, he went one step further than the Hudson's Bay Company. The Hudson's Bay Company just took the land as a charter, assuming no one was there, assuming the land was open. At least Selkirk signed a treaty with the local people, and whether that was lived up to or not is another story. From there, the settlements grew. Settlers arrived in 1813. Actually, the Métis had been established nearby for many generations before that. So as the settlement grew west, treaty was taking place. The first survey was in 1813, when Peter Fiddler did a survey for the Hudson's Bay Company, laying out 24 lots on the north area of, I suppose, north of Dublin area right now along the Red River. Subsequently, in 1822, William Hemp was also appointed to resurvey those lots. I'm not sure what the problem was, but also further lots to the point north of Point Douglas. These narrow river lots existed in the Hildonan area, and that was a pattern that followed in the other areas as surveys continued on. Further on, George Taylor surveys another 1,500 plus lots north of the Assiniboine all the way up to St. Francis Xavier. And here's a pattern. The north side of the river was laid out and surveyed long before Charleswood was, long before the south side of the river. Later on in the 1850s, actually to 1855, 1856, 1857, 1858, and 1860, that's when the further surveys took place. William Minster, Roger Houllet, and Herbert Sabine. Houllet was south of the river, and he did the lots up in Charleswood area, which is part of St. Charles at the time, and Sabine did on the north side. Interesting note, neither one of those last two gentlemen were paid. They're not paid from the public purse, but they receive fees from individuals who asked them to do surveys. So So maybe there was some clarification of some of the property lines that had to be done, and they received their fees directly from the landowners there. The river lot system, basically similar to Scotland and New France, long narrow lots extended back from the river. And of course, that was for a number of reasons. The river was basically the highway, the main transportation route. So you had to have access to that to ship your goods and receive your supplies, but also for access to water for your farm and your family. That's a pattern that existed both in Scotland and in New France. And in terms of the squire system, they also added the further 2 miles. They were 2 miles back from the river, but they also added another 2 miles for hay privilege. They did not own the land, but they had the privilege of cutting hay on that property for the livestock. And what has happened since that time is those 2 mile and 4 mile limits actually became railway routes, and then in some cases road systems. So we see a pattern to take place there. Also, the what we see in some of the properties we have, that farmers may own property on both sides of the river. So they'd be close together and still have those river lots together. Now, the homes are close together, and oftentimes there was a river road that would run alongside. We have the two systems combining, and then the river roads, we still have that today. River road north of Winnipeg and river road to the south in St. Vitale. They're on opposite sides of the river, but basically that's the title they gave them because that's where they were close by. In terms of how these lots were laid out, they used chains. What is a chain? Well, a chain is a 66-foot metal chain that was used to lay out the width of the lots. Some lots were chains wide, some were wider, some were 8 chains wide. So it's basically the amount of the size of the lot that had to be laid out. Some of those measurements are still with us. 10 chains equals a furlong, 10 furlongs to a mile. An acre is a 10 square mile, 10 square chain, 1 chain times a furlong. It's basically a pattern of measurement that continues to this day. As you see here, we have the surveyor's chains. You call them these gunter chains. There's a whole different series of types of chains that they use. This happens to be one example we have. So as we move forward, in terms of people having access to the land is given out a series of ways. Through grants, the Hudson's Bay Company, of course, owned all the land, technically. They sold some of the land. Sometimes land was transferred. In some cases, it went passed down through family. Sometimes there were some family disputes because there may be more than one person in the family expecting to inherit the land, and sometimes issues arose. Other times, there may be issues of property location, so those surveys became important. Also, the survey was fine, but then the land transfer to Canada became a problem because of a different size, different approach to the surveying of the land. We'll talk about that in a moment. We've heard about the fact that the surveyors from Canada were stopped. They were sent out in August 1869. I don't know what time they arrived in the community, but by the time they arrived on Andre Knott's property, they're laying out the square township approach, that was not quite the same as the river lot approach. And of course, tremendous suspicion and animosity existed to start with, not to mention language problems. So the surveyors were stopped in their tracks by Louis Riel and sent packing because this contravened their concept of property. When someone comes on your property, started to measure it out and lay it out, you want to know why. There was problems to start with, and they got exacerbated by that system that came in. So moving ahead, the challenges of the shift to membership in the Canadian Federation, I won't go into detail on that, it would take us too long, but to confirm the script that the Métis had previous to this, there was a script system. They were given script for their land, and it was basically a title. And in some cases, they sold it. In some cases, they didn't. The problem that happened was that it was an unduly complex system. You had to have your script registered, and some people were literate, some people were not. They actually changed the laws. They changed the law 11 times. So you can imagine it was a pretty complex system to start with, plus the fact that there was a swarm of immigrants coming in from Ontario to swamp the Western population here. So there's a big land rush, lots of real estate deals, lots of scams, and lots of nefarious dealings, so that many of the Métis lost title of the land, or they sold it perhaps with not the amount that they could have gotten for it, and eventually moved west to Saskatchewan, where more issues came out. when the same type of problem started happening in 1885. Now, looking at the way the river lots are laid out, the 1907 Assiniboine River lots, as I mentioned, Charleswood was part of St. Charles up until 1913. So it was part of St. Charles Parish. One technicality is, when was St. Charles 1 minute away from St. Boniface? Well, St. Boniface Parish line extended up to roughly Harpazia Street in River Heights, and the other side was St. Charles. So basically, our former council member David McDowell and his wife Linda, their front yard was the dividing line, Harpazia Street, where the extent of St. Charles Parish went to. Subsequently, the lots were laid out in 1850-60, further west on the Assiniboine, south of the river. So we'll just talk about some of the families on those lots, because Charleswood, St. Charles, they actually started in what is now part of River Heights. But moving west, a number of people on those properties figured in Manitoba history. One is the Burke family. John Palmer Burke was one of the original Selkirk settlers and described by others as a very useful man, very helpful to your Selkirk, highly regarded in the community. And his son, Edwin Burke, and others in the family served prominently in the affairs of the community, taking public office, and even his grandson, George Chapman, served as his senior first reeve of Charleswood. However, the property they had, lot 12 and 13, those properties actually wound up being part of Assiniboine Park, the first part of Assiniboine Park, where the entrance to the park is now. Further on, lots 26, that became part of the Assiniboine Park to the west end of the park, where the volleyball court is. And so there was a market garden that his great-grandson, George Chapman, had on that property. And the story is told that the buffalo from Silver Heights, from Lewis Strathorn's farm, used to wander across the river and raid the market garden. And so the boys would have to chase them back across the river. You can imagine that would be quite a daunting task, but apparently they didn't have any problems with those buffalo were pretty tame. I guess they just went easily. Further on, into Charleswood and St. James, the Chapman name is quite renowned because Chapman's been their offspring of the Burks for quite some time. Burkeville on the far side of the river, St. James Collegiate is now on the land that the Burks owned on that side. And Brookfield Community Club is part of that property as well. So moving further, we have the other key family is the Smith family. And lots belong to John Smith, became part of Assiniboine Park. That was just inside the park. The Brookfield property was right beside the Smith family, and their property was just inside what became the inside part of, just inside the gate to Assiniboine Park. He also donated Mr. Smith lots 36 and 37. Chapman's through further west. Now, moving into Charleswood proper, as I mentioned, the lot number one was roughly bounded by Harpazia Street on the far east. But moving into the area, the lots, you can see the Smith and Burke lots on this map. The next one, Charleswood lots 45 to 59. This is where some of the local residents in Charleswood were located. Now, I should note that in settlement in Charleswood, the western edge of Charleswood, and you'll see most of the names that way, are French, and the eastern lots, most of the names there are English. That changed over time, but basically that was a pattern that, that took place. Baptiste Beauchemin and Thomas Ho, those lots, lot 59 and 60, those are lots that figure prominently in a couple of points that we have to make here because of the relation to the passage. The crossing of the Assiniboine River, that was known as the ferry crossing as well. So moving to the next chart, we have lots 54 to 64, and there a bit more prominently you see Baptiste Beauchemin. His property was lot 59, and that is bounded by now the streets that you would call Municipal Road on the east and Bruce Street on the west. And that led down to the passage, which was the famous Buffalo crossing of the river. The passage was famous for the crossing of the buffalo for hundreds of years. Then Aboriginal hunters and Métis hunters following those buffalo up to the plains. And from there, we had that developing as a major crossing point of the Assiniboine. The Assiniboine and other rivers were a passage place. They were a transportation route up and down the rivers, but crossing them was a challenge. So the river was very shallow at the end of that particular lot, the end of Bursa Street, still is shallow. And that was a spot for the settlers, Lord Selkirk, Miles Macdonnell, Hayhuis, Jean-Baptiste Legemaudier. They all crossed there. Matter of fact, Jean-Baptiste Legemaudier built his farm on the north side of the river there, and now that is part of St. Charles Golf Course. Having said that, next door we have the Hull family. Thomas Hull was on lot 60. He was a prominent trainer of buffalo horses, a famous buffalo rider in the past. We'll talk about him in a couple of moments. Most of the families named on this chart still live there. The Heron family, of course, there's many Herons there. We have Heron Park, which is home to the Heron House, often featured in Rose Up in Winnipeg. The former St. Charles Ferry was there across to the river to St. Charles. Herons established that ferry. They had their produce across. They had a very successful dairy and market garden farm there. They established that ferry to get the produce across to the more populous north side to their markets there. But also, it became a major transportation route because at some point in the early 1900s, 1908, the ferry at the passage was shut down because of the water being too shallow. So the St. Charles Ferry continued on up until actually 1959 when the permanent highway was completed. So the Herons made great use of that. And as you can see on the picture, there's a number of people there. There's a horse-drawn carriage. There's also a woman with a parasol, and you probably can't see what's written on her parasol, but it's an advertising slogan for soap. We have pictures of that in our Trousers Historical Society booklet. It's pretty clear that it's an advertising for soap. By Honniers, Morissettes, Herons, they're still with us. I don't know any of the Campbell family, but the Morissettes and Bray Honeys and Herons are still participating in Charleswood Historical Society. We see them quite often. And moving past, I mentioned the fact that the passage. I mentioned the passage was the famous site for the buffalo coming across there. And even going south of the passage, through the woods, when I was a boy, I found that there was paths pounded down to the woods. My grandmother told me that those were not roads to the woods, they were not laneways, they were buffalo trails. And the ground had been pounded down so hard that the trees would never grow there, but grass would grow. So the buffalo would come across in thousands and head out to the prairies, just to the end of Charles Road, and then off to the southwest, out to the plains. And of course, the hundreds of Métis buffalo hunters and their families in the Red River Hearts would follow them twice a year out to the plains for the semi-annual buffalo hunts, once in the spring, once in the fall. That spot, the passage between the two river lots between 60 and 59 was well known. In terms of that operation of the ferry was originally run by Baptiste Bushman, who had lot 59, and then he gave it up and Thomas Hull started to run the ferry in the about 1883. As I say, the ferry ran between those two families and others up until 1908, and then it was shut down, and then the whole ferry operation was moved to St. Charles. Going further, the family lots, the Boschemans, as I mentioned, there were still some of them living there when I was growing up. I met some of the family. Baptiste, his son, had donated part of the land for the Red Birch Road, which was built in about 1914, I believe it was. It was originally named Boschemans Road, then they changed it to Charleswood Road. Boschemans Park that surrounds it, this is where the Charleswood Legion is now. Bushman Park is named after the family, and Bushman Park Place is the seniors' home that's there. Actually, when I was growing up out there in the 50s, Grandma Bushman still lived in the area. She lived in the house that was right beside the school because that was originally part of the property the family owned. I have a picture then about the Bushman family on lot 59. Bill Bushman, son of Baptiste, he was actually born in the buffalo hunt, played a part in Métis politics over the years in the late 1800s. And we have, as I say, family members still attending and participating with us in terms of the Historical Society events. The Hoves I mentioned, there's a number of Hoves there. There's Joseph Hove and Amaba Hove. Now, Amaba Hove, his son, Antoine, ran the ferry, as did Tom. But Amaba had been married to Margaret Taylor, who was formerly married to George Simpson, governor of the Hudson's Bay Company. Antoine ran the ferry between up to the 1880s, and then Thomas Holtz, a little bit, a bit earlier, 1883, they ran that together. The family is pictured here. On the other side of the river, lot 105 in St. Charles, Lewis Holt had that. He was a relation on the other side. And Thomas Holt, in the center of this picture, as I mentioned, he was well-known for breeding buffalo runners, famous buffalo runner himself. So he did really well in that area and was a popular person to have purchased your buffalo hunters from. Moving to the last couple of charts we have here, this is a different chart. This one has a Tuxedo Park plan. Now, Tuxedo was set up as a separate municipality in a separate township, actually, in about 1913. And I note there because the original land spot planned for University of Manitoba was in Tuxedo, opposite the Assiniboine Park. And one might wonder what happened about that, because they had established also a town site in Charleswood called Varsity View. The pretext was that you could see the university from there, it was close by. So that was one of the selling points of the property they sold in Varsity View. Somehow, something changed, and they moved the property, they moved the university off to Fort Garry campus, and no one ever knew what happened there. Basically, maybe some money changed hands or some thoughts changed hands. Maybe they needed more space. You can't imagine the space of that they would have to use now. So Varsity View retained its name. The property actually then became Tuxedo Golf Course. And as we wrap up, I just have a picture here of some, what we believe is Red River Heart tracks on lot 70, 71, heading towards the Permanent Highway. We feel they may be part of the old Bay St. Paul Road. So this has been a bit of a tour of river lots we have, some of the families involved, a bit of background of the history of the river lots in Charleswood and the passage, stories related to those. Thank you very much.